You'll see things that remind you of those areas.
Kristen, anything look familiar to you here?
Oh, very much so. I grew up in Florida.
Okay. Okay.
Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of PlayStation Underground. You got Tim and Kristen here.
Hey.
And we're joined by some special guests from Ghost Games. We're checking out Need for Speed Heat. We have Riley Cooper, who's Crave director on the game.
Hello.
We also have Mike Harton, who's the narrative designer.
Hey, thanks for having me.
And then at the controls off mic is Mike Geary, producer on the game. So thank you so much for joining us, guys, for a look at the at Need for Speed Heat.
Mm. Yeah, great to
Absolutely.
Be here.
I was
gonna say,
yeah.
We're catching a cutscene right now. We are playing on a PS4 Pro. But set the scene for us a little bit. Guys, what's going on?
Yeah, we got some breaking news here.
So this first scene is introducing the player to the world that we've created, which is Palm City, and our cops, which are our primary antagonists in this experience.
All right.
Yeah, so you're just getting kind of the lay of the land.
Got it.
Yeah.
Okay, so Palm City... does it have a bit of a crime problem? Is that?
Well, street racers
gotcha.
are in town.
An epidemic.
I'm yeah. living for the bottom bit, potato voted best vegetable ever. Major news, you guys.
Controversial.
All right, so we have a press conference, assuming the police department's going to really try to crack down on this issue, and that may be a problem for us, the player.
That's right.
Exactly. So they've created a high-speed task force meant to... and street racing, essentially.
Okay. Oh, gotcha. And then we have a transition straight into gameplay here, which is great. Now, I see we're starting at night here. Presumably, we're kind of like clicking into some sort of tutorial early, sort of, you know, get your bearings below you gameplay here.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Cool.
So, you know, we have like day and night modes in this game, right?
We do.
And does it affect your racing? Does it affect sort of the environments around you?
It does. Night is always street racing. Day is always sanctioned racing.
Mm-hmm.
And so at night you have cops, you have traffic. It's a much more hectic experience.
I was going to say already, we got a cop right behind us. Chased by one cop.
Now, do we see any difference in the behavior between like the police between day and night?
We do. So day cops basically play by the rules.
Okay.
They're more or less what you would expect a cop to do. And at night, the cops are kind of in it for themselves a little bit. They're
really?
Kind of, yeah, they're kind of thrill seekers themselves.
And some personal vendettas and axes to grind.
Oh, dang.
Oh, wow. And so are they doing like pit maneuvers against you? And you see like a mix of some more avant-garde techniques from the cops at night?
They're definitely more aggressive.
Okay.
Yeah, they're
That's
more aggressive.
See.
So I know that, like, you know, the police and the pursuit of you know, the law has been a really long-running, you know, theme with the Need for Speed series. How does it sort of evolve in Heat here?
Running from the law?
Yeah.
So, you know... Over the time that I've been at Ghost and over the course of the games, the cops' ability to pursue and kind of provide an interesting challenge has evolved. So on Payback, we made huge strides where the cops were much more capable of keeping up with you on this in an open world,
okay.
which is kind of a challenge. And then on this game, we've evolved it further to be a little bit more grounded. Where in general your primary goal is to just outrun them.
Okay.
But you can still battle tactically if there's a good opportunity to maybe knock a cop off your trail.
Makes sense. I suppose engaging in any way is always going to decrease your speed a little bit, so you just kind of want to outrun them. But
and health.
And health. Okay, gotcha.
Yeah.
So how significant of a role is like your car's like health and durability in this?
It is very significant. So when you enter night, you know, essentially your health is always going down and you're trying to get as much rep as you can before your car wrecks or before you get busted.
Oh, speaking of
which might be happening
here.
Right now.
Let's check this out.
Oh no. Oh. Welp.
Sploosh.
That's not great.
What did you do?
What'd
you do to that sweet ass ride?
Oh no.
You lost the car.
He lost the car.
No, Shaw. This is on you.
You're gonna wish you never survived.
Who says he did?
Oh, boy. the cop?
What are we doing here?
Sending a message.
It is.
Wait, wait, stop!
Hey, hey, he said...
We're on camera back there!
Shaw, hold it.
Ooh, we got some tension.
Yeah.
So this is how we work now?
These crews gotta learn. Try making a mockery of my unit, you're gonna take the fall.
Frank, you're smarter than this. You want to send a message? You need a messenger.
You, get out of town. And if we see you or any of your crew around here again, you're gonna be joining that car. You understand? Get
up. Water. That's what he means.
Exactly. Or taking a swim.
Yeah.
Just a light, brisk swim. I can already sort of get a sense of the building storyline there.
Yeah, it seems like the law enforcement has had enough, and they have kind of changed their playbook a little bit.
They have.
There's still some tension there.
Yeah.
There is, and they were very upset about losing that car.
Yeah.
So it starts to give you a little bit of a clue about maybe what their motivation is.
Yeah. Interesting, interesting.
But in general as well, you know, cops is what sets Need for Speed apart, having that dynamic.
Yeah.
So we really wanted to take advantage of that.
Yeah.
Just casually walking back.
Yeah.
Hey, what happened, bro? Where the hell's your car? Hey.
This is bullshit, Anna. Yeah, I'm out. I'm going back to Ventura, and I'm taking Richie with me.
But we're a crew.
Not anymore. It's over.
What? You're just gonna walk to Ventura?
Apparently.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's a short walk.
It's cars in the water.
So. You know, public transit.
Yeah, yeah, there's that. There is that. So establishing the stakes early on here, then.
Exactly, and giving us some insight on the crew of cops who we'll see throughout the campaign. So those three characters, you have Lieutenant Frank Mercer, and then the woman was Officer Eva Torres, and then Danny Shaw was the first one on the scene. And you'll see them throughout the campaign.
Awesome. Yeah. How would you, how you know, important would you say the, or how big of a role does the story take place throughout the campaign?
I think it there's a good mix here. So we're trying to let gameplay lead the way. This time, Payback was much more narratively focused.
Yeah.
So it's definitely a core component of the campaign, but we really wanted to make the experience open so that the player choose to play as much of the campaign as they want or not, essentially.
Okay, you can kind of just opt into as much as you want.
Exactly.
Take your own time.
So we have a leveling system, and you can level all the way to the end of the game without playing much more than this opening
sequence. Oh, really? Okay, cool. Yeah, it's always nice just to kind of, you know, get the keys, so to speak, and be able to just go in any direction you want.
Yeah. But it's also nice to check out the garage.
Of course. Yeah, so is this a sort of a garage that you come back to recurring?
Exactly. So this is really the home base that you'll be in throughout the campaign.
Okay.
And the introduction that we saw just a few seconds ago at night on the bridge was one of our core narrative campaign characters, and that's Anna.
Mm-hmm.
And then inside the garage now, we're going to meet the character of Lucas.
Okay. That's enough.
It's a little too much bullshit this early in the day. I hate to do this, but if you're looking for wheels, I got a CID.
Ooh.
Cops insist.
All right, so now we are the player character.
Exactly.
Got it.
So stepping into character selection here.
Okay.
Which is, I think, a new thing for us. We haven't had a time where you choose a character in a Need for Speed before.
Oh, cool.
No, absolutely. That's one of the big differences in narrative this time around. So instead of, you know, we've had in our last two releases a silent protagonist that was first person. And then in Payback, we had really defined characters where we basically decided who they were. And in this one, we're striking kind of a balance where the character does speak, but you pick them, you customize them, and mostly, you know, their speaking is kind of questions about what's going on.
Okay.
So we're trying to create space for the player to really inhabit that character.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
They're good. Why don't you take a look?
That's great. And I know that, you know, in addition to from what I've seen of the game so far, that in addition to being able to choose that sort of character as a starting point, that there's a lot of customization just in terms of, you know, what you want to wear and what kind of style you have. And both, like, because the car is, like, fully customizable, but so is your outfit, right?
Exactly.
That's awesome. Beamer, you
want to go for it? Yeah, I was customizing my character for the first time once we had the feature up. And then once I was done with that, I was like, well, now I need to style my car.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
My car needs to go with my character.
Yeah.
So it's kind of an onboarding to kind of self-expression in the game.
That's great. Sounds good. And then what's the relation here between these characters? Is he just a sort of on the up and up, mechanic slash car dealer, or...
Yeah, he's a clean character,
okay.
So he's not involved in the illicit activity.
Got it.
As you play through the story a little bit more, you'll realize that it's an area that he's familiar with.
Mm.
Cool.
And so now we're on the way to the first showdown event. So one of the big concepts of this game is having the Speed Hunter Showdown.
Awesome.
Which is a sanctioned
event.
Yeah, exactly. Sanctioned event, so... very, I guess, in a sense, pro street esque.
Got it.
Okay.
We've moved into the daytime, a little bit different.
Yeah, I really love the vibe of the city and like how different it feels from the nighttime. Nighttime just kind of has like this sort of like, you know, a neon drenched, you know, rain slick look to it. And this is just much more grounded, but still really cool. So, what is. I get like a subtle, like a kind of a Miami vibe. Does this actually take place in like a fictional Florida city? Is that kind of what we're looking at, or?
I think that's basically fair.
Okay.
We took inspiration from the entire southeastern U.S., but Miami was definitely one of the spots.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you'll see things that remind you of those areas.
Kristen, anything look familiar to you here?
Oh, very much so. I grew up in Florida.
Okay.
For reference.
Okay. You joining
us? Nah, man. So now this is an introduction to what we call driving story characters.
Okay.
So this will be a side quest character you'll meet again throughout the campaign.
So driving stories are side quests.
Exactly.
Okay, very cool.
So, you know, as Mike was saying earlier, you don't have to play the campaign, but if you want and you choose to do the side stories too, you can kind of stay in a narratively wrapped experience if you want as well. You can kind of take it both ways.
Awesome. I love all the like the hot pink and just like the aesthetic. Like, what can you say about sort of the aesthetic wrapping of Heat in general?
So, you know, there's a few influences, but you know, we wanted to do something that was felt very modern.
Yeah.
But then also striking a balance, particularly in the sanctioned events, between something that's kind of big and exciting, but also has kind of a street vibe to it.
Yeah.
So it was kind of threading a needle between those two components.
Oh. Nice overtook first place there. Well, yeah, it looks really great. And now I know like there's a little bit of interplay between what you do in the daytime and then how that affects when you click over into, you know, nighttime. What can you say sort of about like the risk reward of, you know, those two modes?
So day is really about opportunity. You can look on the map, you can see which events are available, and you know, make a plan and pick the events that you think you can win that also give you the most bank.
Yeah.
And that is probably the biggest distinction, is day's reward is bank.
Okay.
So you go to day to build up your, you know, your arsenal, your war chest. And then when you're ready and you've built your car to be exactly what you want it to be, both visually and from a performance perspective, you choose to go to night.
Okay.
And then night is very different, because night, basically, you push it as hard as you can, but it will come to an end.
Okay.
And it's either it's because you made it back to a safe house or your car got wrecked or you were busted.
Okay. Just basically, how far do you want to push it? How lucky are you feeling?
Exactly. And then heat works two ways. So the more you race at night, the more your heat goes up. Which is bad in a way, because it means you're going to get more cop attention. But it also acts as a multiplier on the rep you've earned. So you have this incentive to keep pushing it and an incentive to maybe stop.
Okay.
So every night is kind of that challenge. But it's a very different pacing.
Yeah.
And so by having day night, it allows players to have experiences that are much more relaxed at their own pace. Like day's a great time to look for collectibles, things like that.
Yeah.
I was going to say, this map seems pretty broad. Like, how would you say it compares to previous Need for Speed games?
It's, you know, since Ghost has had the franchise, so four games now, this will be the fourth. This is the densest road network we've ever had.
Okay.
And I think it's the most drivable world we've ever had. One of the things that, you know, we've always known, but we just did a better job with this time, is that dead stops really close to the road tend to produce not the best driving experience.
Okay.
So we've been really aggressive about pushing dead stops away from the sides of the roads. So you can really get into a groove. We've also used, real world road design rules,
okay,
which help with readability. So when you're driving, you can anticipate turns in general.
All right.
They're wide enough. The roads are wide enough. Just every detail that contributes to a better driving experience. We've really done the best job we've ever done.
That's really cool.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. We're seeing this character again.
Yeah.
So this is the meeting between this Anna character and the player character, and you find that she's related. She's the sister of the garage owner. So that's kind of our connection to the garage through Anna.
They're only selling if they know you're going to put the parts to good use. I do like her hair.
Okay. Rookie's got confidence. How about a chance to prove you're more than just talk?
Oh, boy.
Let's do it.
Give me your phone.
Okay.
I'm Anna. There's only one way to make a name.
She's so cool.
Yeah.
And she's the guide into the night half of the game. So we have Lucas, who kind of introduces you to day events and day characters. And then Anna, who shows us everything night.
Nice.
Okay, cool.
I like her car.
And they're siblings. It's perfect.
So yeah, of course, you know, these games have a large arsenal of cars. Which one would you guys say is your favorite?
Yeah.
It changes.
Yeah.
But I'm into the R34, GTR R34 right now. I got to see some. We did a reference gathering trip in Florida. And we happened upon a group of guys who had almost a warehouse full of imported R34s. And they're quite impressive in person.
Wow.
Yeah. So that's my current favorite, I would say.
I'm a fan of one of the starter cars, the 180SX, and with one of the features we've introduced this year, engine swaps, we can kind of keep that car throughout the entire campaign.
Oh, really?
You level it up.
So if you really fall in love with a certain, you know, car model, you can just sort of follow it through and soup it up, or you can follow the new shiny thing if you want. So that's
exactly
awesome.
Yeah.
And then how would you say, you know, for me, like, I've always been a little bit more on, like, the arcadey side of racing games, and I think that a lot of Need for Speeds kind of cater to whether you're, like, a gearhead or more arcadey, but how do you feel like Heat caters to, you know, either side of the coin as far as what type of racing fan you are?
So our default handling model leans towards drift, as you see Mike taking these corners with a kind of a default car. And it's very accessible. We call it our heroic driving model.
Okay.
But then as you progress, you unlock more and more parts. So one of the things Rep does for you is it kind of lets people know who you are. So then they're willing to sell the better parts to you, because it's kind of a tight market, because all the racers are in town.
Cool.
And so as you unlock better and better parts, you gain the ability to equip parts that will make your car handle in a more extreme drift fashion, or a more extreme grip fashion.
Okay.
And then each of those require more skill.
Yeah.
But they're opt-in. So you can beat the game with the default handling model, just kind of right down the middle. Or if you really want to set the fastest race times, you go extreme grip.
Okay.
If you want to set the highest drift scores, you go extreme drift.
Okay.
So the player has a lot. Yeah, exactly. The player has a lot of agency.
That's awesome. I also got to say, we saw it a second ago, but I love the transition into nighttime, like the sort of like camera flipping upside down.
Yeah.
And, that was great.
Very cool. So I saw there was a prompt for a second that there was a billboard nearby. Is that sort of a side quest of something you can be doing?
It is. So smashing billboards is kind of a Need for Speed staple.
Yeah.
Little unruly
just
behavior.
Just confirming, making sure that's still there.
It is.
Excellent. So yeah, where are we off to next?
So Anna's showing us, it's essentially an invitation to our first night event. So she's going to show us the night scene and give us a chance to prove ourselves.
Cool. And, you know, speaking of nighttime and the cops being a little bit more aggressive, I understand that, you know, cops have more than just cars at their disposal when, you know, your heat level raises enough. Like, what else do they throw at you?
So we have spike strips.
Okay.
We have a helicopter.
Really?
If the helicopter's on you, it's very hard to get away.
Yeah, no kidding.
We have something we call rhinos, which are essentially
rhinoceroses. The animal, I'm familiar. It's
they don't look like that though. They look like SWAT trucks.
Okay, cool.
And they tend to be driven head on right at you.
Okay.
So
you just take a turn and suddenly there's a rhino and it ruins your race and you gotta adapt on the fly.
It'll take a chunk of health off you for sure.
I love that countdown clock. Like, it's great design.
Really stylish.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I see the aesthetically, like, I love the sort of night vibe here.
Yeah.
But I also appreciate that you can opt in and out and that, you know, you can kind of control whether you want to go to one or the other and balance things out that way. Now, I know that usually you have to, you know, once you bank you sort of gain enough points and cash that you kind of have to bank it or you lose it all. Does that mechanic work similarly to previous Need for Speeds or?
Yeah, Rivals featured a similar mechanic where you could, you it's a similar dynamic. And actually, one of the things we like about this is by having Day, now that intensity has a chance to kind of subside and you can kind of take it a little bit easier during Day and kind of drive at your own pace. Mm. So we have, you know, we feel like we've by adding Day, this intensity level is much more manageable.
Cool.
Yeah. You can have longer play sessions.
Yeah, I like the tension of trying to get to a safe house is something I really liked about Rivals, and I think that's cool that'll be represented in Heat. And so your heat level, again, so it's sort of like almost like a multiplier, is that right?
It is. Okay. It is. So right now, you know, you can see up there, he's got no heat.
Okay.
But it will start to climb. He should have some after that race.
Okay.
We'll see
some behavior changes from the cops.
You will. Okay. You will. Much more intense pursuits and faster cars, more aggressive maneuvers.
Awesome.
Yeah. Check it out.
You see anything you like?
All of them. Think he'll be up for a race?
I will take that one.
You got a little way to go before they give you a shot.
And that car too, please.
Who's they?
The League.
Oh my God.
They've been around for years. Showdown floods this place with new blood. They surface and check out the town. And once you're in, it's access to everything. Best cars, races, parts. You want to know why we're here every single night?
Yeah.
That's your answer.
This is a typical Friday night for me. Yeah. You believe it. So, I mean, we've been checking out the... Oh, this is cool. Get a sense of
the map, yeah.
The map a little bit and how expansive it might get. It's great. How dramatically does, you know, sort of one area vary from the other?
Yeah. Quite a bit. There's a lot of character in the world. That was the goal, is to have distinct regions of the world have their own identity. And, yeah, it's even on that level, it's the best world we've ever built.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Too bad. It's having fun.
You can keep racing if you want. It's your choice. Just remember, if you're gonna get in trouble, don't get caught. Kind of ruins the whole name-making thing.
And then, you know, we've been focusing primarily on some of, like, the more single-player focused stuff. But what is the sort of multiplayer element and any other parts of, like, the online experience you want to talk to?
Sure. There's three main components. We'll see if I can remember all three. The first one is you can go online. You can join an online server. And then when you're in the world between events, other players will be in the world as well. The other is that if you're on this on a server with other players and you start a race, you have the option of inviting everyone on the server to join your race.
Okay.
And then we have a new feature, which is a crew feature. So that garage you saw, when you go back to it, it'll be populated with other players in your crew. Okay. You'll see their character. You'll see their car.
Kind of a social space type
much
vibe.
More of a social vibe. Yeah. And then in the world, there's events that are set up to be just crew competition.
Okay.
And so you'll be able to, you know, try to be set the fastest times in your crew on any of those events.
Nice. That's awesome.
Then the good thing about it being, you know, kind of an asynchronous feature is every time you log in, your crew will be there.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah.
Made our way back to first here.
Yeah, nice.
Courtesy of Mike's driving.
Let's see if he can hang on to it.
He's doing pretty well. Despite the rain.
I'd bet on Mike. We'll see, though. It is live software.
Yeah. Yeah, you know. So this is... I also see that there's a map in the lower left just sort of helping you chart your course as well.
Yeah.
Which is really handy. I feel like when you race, do you tend to use the mini map much, or do you try to focus on just what's in front of you?
The mini map is just to make sure that you're on the right course.
Okay.
It's basically a backup tool in an event.
Yeah. It seems like there's definitely enough cues to stay on course just by looking at the track itself.
That's the goal.
Oh, nice. Nice work. Well, very cool. Is there, one final, story mission or driving mission or anything else we want to check out before we say goodbye? Oh, we're going to maybe try to
push the limits a little bit. Push it.
See if we can get the attention of the local law enforcement.
So you can
Hello,
see them.
Mr. Cops.
Yeah.
You can see him on the mini map. He's heading straight for him.
Okay. Oh, here we go.
So if you want to antagonize the police, here's what to do. Follow that minimap.
And so their goal is just to, especially at night, just ram you and do damage and
box
you out of service,
in.
Basically.
Exactly. Yeah. They want to end your night on their terms.
Gotcha. And the penalty for that being that, anything that you had accrued, is it a big hit to the sort of like...
We don't take everything.
Okay.
Because we don't want, we don't want you to feel like you didn't get something for your time, your play time, but it's much less.
Okay.
So if you lose your... Basically, you lose your multiplier.
Okay, got
it. So you get a base level of rep instead of, times two, times three.
That's good.
Yeah.
And any tips
Heat level just went up.
Like, my instinct when I'm getting chased by the cops, almost in any game, is like, wait till they're next to me, and then I slam on the brakes and just hope that it's like an action movie and they spin out of control and like...
That's
go
a
ahead.
Tactic.
That works well in intersections, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Intersections. That's a good tip. Any other pointers for how to shake the cops?
It depends on what heat level you're at. Like, at a low heat... It's really good to hit a straight road and kind of outrun these low-level cops. Mm-hmm. That tactic expires at higher heat levels.
Okay.
Got it.
One very good tactic is if you knock them really hard, if they pull up beside you and you knock them really hard, they will lose control for a few seconds, and that can be the difference.
Okay.
All right. Gotcha. Well, we have successfully escaped.
Yeah. Well done, Mike, if the control's there. Absolutely. So, Riley, Mike... thank you so much for joining us on an episode of PlayStation Underground. So this is Need for Speed Heat. It is coming out on November 8th, so not that much longer to wait now.
No, it's right around the corner.
Yeah, and thanks everyone for watching. We'll see you next time.
Awesome, thanks.
Thank you. PlayStation.